Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I am taking over church today.
Church or the children's group?
Church.
Oh, that's good. Very interesting.
I am your replacement pastor for today.
All right. So where is our original pastor?
He is on vacation.
Okay.
With his family.
But okay.
I'm sure they will be joining soon as well.
All right, that's great. That is great.
Summer's not on, but good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Apparently,
you know the correct English
is
that you're
going to have a posh speaker. It sounds a bit high.
Anything else?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, volume's very low on our side. Let you put the volume.
Well, I like your talk. I like your talk. Is it hot there? Can you hear me?
Me?
Yes, yes. Is it hot?
Nah.
Oh, no, it's not hot. Okay. Your top is very high.
Hello, everybody.
No, I'm here by myself.
No.
Ah, okay. You're here by yourself. Oh,
we're with you.
We are with you.
We can see you.
Pastor Tim.
Uh-huh. I am ready to take your job.
Yeah. Go for it, girl. You know, the young child gets...
Guys, I'll be muting you all as we start our 5-minute countdown.
Thank you.
pay, and now we shall have our opening prayer for today. Heavenly and most gracious Father, we come before you in prayer to magnify and glorify your precious name and to give all the praise, honor, and glory you deserve. We humbly request your overflowing blessings upon our lives. We also take this opportunity to thank you for those who have blessings you have bestowed upon us, that we take for granted, and the numerous ones on the way. Bless us with love, joy, peace, and happiness. Bless us spiritually, financially, and also with good health. Keep us safe, O loving Lord. Those among us who lack wisdom, bless them with knowledge. Those who are weak, bless them with strength. Shower with energy those who are weary. Those who are blind, bless with sight. And those who are burdened, set completely free. Shower these blessings on our family and friends as well. Help us all to remember that we are blessed to be a blessing to others. Help us to help others even when we're struggling with our own difficulties. Lord, you know the desires of our hearts, and you also know what we deserve. Bless us with what you know is truly best for us. Thank you for all you have done for us. And we declare that your overflowing blessings will rain down upon us today, in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. We will now have our two worship songs, so please feel free to sing along.
Stop the Lord Almighty. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin. Breaks the chains.
We will now listen to our Bible reading of Psalm 23.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and loving kindness shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the Lord's house forever.
We'll now have our sermon for today. The sermon title being Let Go and Trust God.
God doesn't want me worrying about anything. Nothing, nada, zip, zero. Philippians 4:6, don't worry about anything. That's pretty clear. Instead, pray about everything. We've talked about this many times. You can pray or you can panic. If you're not praying, you're panicking. You can worry or you can worship. If you're not worshiping, you're worrying. You invite worship in the front door, worry goes out the back door. And so God says, I don't want you worrying about anything. Now why? He says, worry is unreasonable. It's unreasonable. In other words, it doesn't make sense. It's illogical. It is irrational. It is unreasonable. In the first place, we typically worry about the wrong thing. We worry about the little stuff. How I look, how I appear, what I say, who I'm talking to. Stuff, am I going to be late for this meeting? Stuff that isn't going to matter in 5 years. It's all temporary. If you're really going to worry, and God says you shouldn't, but if you were going to worry, worry about things that are eternal. Don't worry about stuff that's not going to matter tomorrow. Jesus says you should never worry, not only because it's unreasonable, it's unnatural. Nature does not worry. It's unnatural. Jesus says, you know, look at the birds. Look at the birds of the air. They don't sow or reap or store away in barns. They're not worried about, you know, do I have enough to live on? And he said, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than birds? If God takes care of birds, isn't he going to take care of you? And then he says in verse 28 and 29, Matthew 6, why do you worry about your clothes? You go out and look at the flowers. Look at the field lilies. They don't worry about how they look. Yet King Solomon, all of his glory, was not clothed as beautifully as they are. And he said, all of creation trust my care except humans. He's saying worry isn't natural. Jesus says worry is unhelpful. What does he mean by that? It's useless. It doesn't work. Worry is worthless. It doesn't change anything when you worry. Matthew 6, verse 27, Jesus says, "Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life?" Worry can't make you an inch taller. Worry can't make you an inch shorter. Can't make you bigger or smaller, thinner or fatter. Worry doesn't work. He says, "Who of you can change anything?" He says, "You can't add even a single hour to your life." Worry about any problem in your life will never move you one step toward that situation. Worry is worthless. Worry cannot change anything in your past. It's already done. Your past is past. So why are you worried about it? Worry cannot control your future. No matter how much you think you can, you're not controlling it by worrying about it. So if it can't change the past and it can't control the future, what does it do? Messes up today. And he says, there's no need to worry because your heavenly Father will take care of you. You know, when I was a kid, if I had any need in my life, I didn't worry about it. I just went to my dad. I said, "Dad, I need this," or, "Mom, I need this." And if I needed money to buy something, I'd say, "Dad, I need some money to buy this." I never once worried about where he was going to get the money. That was his worry. You're worrying about a lot of things that are God's responsibility. Worry is assuming responsibility that God never intended for you to have. Every time you worry, it's a warning light. I'm playing God. I'm acting like God. I'm thinking that it all depends on me, that I don't have a heavenly Father. So you never worry if you understand that God is your heavenly Father and you understand the goodness of God. Matthew 6, verse 30 says this, "If God cares so wonderfully, even for the flowers that are here today and gone tomorrow," in other words, they're only going to bloom for a few days and then they're gone, but your life lasts decades. "If God cares so wonderfully, even for the flowers that are here today and gone tomorrow, won't he surely care for you?" You see, what he's saying here is that God has assumed responsibility for you, the needs in your life. And he cares for you because he says you are valuable. You have value. You want to know how much you value? Look at the cross. Jesus died for you on the cross. That shows how much value you have to God. You're not junk. You're not worthless. No, no. You are valuable to God because you're his child. And like the shepherd takes care of the defenseless sheep, when you need it, I'm there. What am I saying? I'm saying that worry in your life, every time you worry, it comes from the fact that you misunderstand the goodness of God. Worry is a warning sign. It's a yellow caution light going bomp, bomp, bomp. That's saying, at this point, I've forgotten how good God is. I've forgotten the promises of God. I've forgotten what God has promised to do in my life to meet all my needs. He says it over and over and over. I will meet all your needs. There's no need that God will not meet if you trust him. Now, if you don't trust him, you're out there on your own. But if you trust him, he says, I will meet every need in your life. And worry means I've forgotten that, the goodness of God. It comes from misunderstanding what God is really like. And you know what? We always get into trouble every time whenever we start doubting God's goodness. When we start thinking, God's not going to take care of me. God doesn't really love me. God isn't a good God. Every time you start thinking like that, and you know where those thoughts came from, you're going to get in trouble. You're going to go down a blind alley, hit a dead end, have all kinds of discouragement in your life. And it doesn't even make sense. Most of you here, sitting here this day, are believers. You've stepped across the line spiritually. You've said, you know, I've put my trust in Jesus Christ because I know heaven's perfect and I'm not. There's no chance I'm getting to heaven on my own goodness because I'm not good enough. So I'm trusting Jesus Christ to forgive me and to save me by his grace, not by my works, but I'm just trusting God to save me because he loves me. He wants to forgive me. He sent Jesus to die for me. When Jesus died on the cross for you, he solved your biggest problem. You don't have any bigger problem than eternal salvation. But if that's your biggest problem, why do you doubt his taking care of the smaller things in your life? What's the logic of saying, I'm going to trust God to get me to heaven, but I'm not going to trust him to help me make my car payment? What's the logic in that? It makes no sense. Why would you trust God with something so big, eternal salvation, but not trust him with, who am I supposed to marry? Or am I ever going to get married? Or am I going to get a job? Or what school should I go to? And all the other major questions in life. Why don't you trust him with those things too? It doesn't make sense to say, oh, I don't doubt him for my salvation, but I do doubt that he's going to care for my health. I do doubt that he's going to care for my career. It doesn't make sense at all. If God can be trusted for salvation, he'll carry everything else. And when you doubt that, you are an unbeliever at that moment. You're an unbeliever. Every time you worry, you act like an unbeliever. You see, it's actually an insult to God every time you worry. You're acting like an orphan every time you worry. You're acting like you don't have a heavenly father who has promised over and over again, over 3,000 promises in this book, to take care of your needs. How many times do you act like God doesn't know what you need? And we start depending on ourselves, and we start taking matters into our own hands, and we assume that we have to figure it all out rather than just trusting. That's called playing God. When we get to heaven, you're going to see how many times you set yourself up for failure by worrying instead of trusting. John chapter 14, verse 1, Jesus says this, "Don't be worried." What do I do instead of worrying? He says, "Believe in God and believe in me." Now, how do you do that? How do you trust God to meet your needs? Number one, and you do this every day. It's not a one-time thing. Every day, ask him to be my shepherd. Every day, I ask Jesus to be my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. You do this every morning. When you get up, you sit on the side of your bed and you say, "The Lord is my shepherd." And then I say it throughout the day. You got a major decision to make. The Lord is my shepherd. You might say it 10 or 15 times a day. But if you'll start saying that phrase, your worry will go down. Every time you start to worry, you need to say, "The Lord is my shepherd." Now in John chapter 10, Jesus says this, verse 14, 15, "I am the good shepherd." When you say the Lord's my shepherd, who is that? Jesus says, I'm him. I am the Lord. I am the good shepherd. And I know my own sheep and they know me, and I lay down my life for my sheep. That's what he did on the cross. He gave his life for you. Second, it's very important. I give him, Jesus, first place in every area of my life. This is extremely important. That I give Jesus first place in every area of my life. Now the Bible says this, Matthew 6, verse 31, 33. Your heavenly Father already knows perfectly well what you need. Now, let me stop right there. Your heavenly Father perfectly knows already what you need. So any need you mention to God, he already knows. So anytime you come to God with needs, he's not going to go, "Whoa, I never saw that one coming." He knew it before he made you. But he says, "I already know what you need before you even ask." And he says, "And he will," not might, "he will give you what you need if," here's the condition, "if you give him first place in your life and you live as he wants you to." So you give God first place in every area of your life. Now, let me just tell you something. Anytime you worry, that is a warning light that that particular area of your life, you have not given him first place. When you make Jesus Christ number one in every single area of your life, it really simplifies your priorities, and it also gives you a whole lot less to worry about. See, when it's given to God, then you don't have to worry about it. Too often we worry about things. We worry about physical possessions. Now, as long as you love anything else in your life more than God, that area is going to become a source of worry to you. Just count on it. It's going to become a source of stress and a source of insecurity if you love it more than God. You're going to be victimized by worry and anxiety. And eventually, everybody has to decide, you and me and everybody else, what am I going to live for and who am I going to live for? And whatever that answer is, becomes your Lord. You know, one of the things we worry about the most, of course, is money. What I've discovered is that no matter how much or how little you've got of it, about it, you still worry about it. And if you don't have it, you worry about getting it. If you've got it, you worry about keeping it, saving it, spending it, investing it, protecting it. And God says, I don't want you worrying about that. I'll take care of all your needs. Matthew chapter 6, verse 34, Jesus says this. So don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will have its own worries. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Anybody agree with that verse? Can't change the future, can't change the past, just work on today. There are 2 days of every week you should never worry about. Yesterday and tomorrow. Because you can't do anything about them. Take one day at a time through your life. Now why? Why does God say that you should only live your life one day at a time? Well, because it's true. It's the only thing you can do. You can't live in the past. You can't live in the future. You can only live today. But there's a couple reasons why you should only live one day at a time. First, when you worry about tomorrow's problems, you miss all the blessings of today. Some of you are so worried about retirement, you're not enjoying today. It's okay to plan for tomorrow. It's okay to plan for the future. Just don't worry about the future. Planning is good. Worrying is bad. You can plan for tomorrow, but you can't live in tomorrow. You can only live today. Now, I know that the future can often seem, you know, very overwhelming. But God graciously divided it up into 24-hour segments. So you don't get all the future at once. You get it 24 hours at a time. And if God gave you all the future at one time, it would overwhelm you. But you're not there yet. You're not ready for it. So it's not going to come at you all at once. You're going to hit the future one day at a time. You can handle that. Why? Because the Lord is my shepherd.
Right, we'll have communion now. So for communion, I'll play this song, and then after the song is finished, please feel free to take your communion elements.
We worship you. I worship.
Take your communion elements. We'll now have our prayers for today. So first we will have one of the Akandes take us for prayer of restoration. We'll then have Auntie Neoma take prayer of promise and Auntie Bumi for prayer of protection. Please unmute yourselves when you're ready to pray and remember to mute yourselves again when you are finished. Thank you.
Father God, we just come to give you all the glory. We thank you, Lord, for being a God that restores. a God that never gives up, a God that keeps at us and keeps with us in all that we go through. Father, we thank you for the new day. We thank you that you not just restore, you don't refurbish, you make anew. You make everything that is old new. You make everything that is battered and everything that is broken new. Father, we thank you because the Bible tells us that your glory and your grace and your blessing is new and every morning. We thank you for the new blessing of today, for the new blessing of this month, for the new blessing of the month that we're going to in September. And Father God, we just want to give you all the glory and all the honor. And Father, we just pray, oh Lord, that you who restore, will restore all that concerns us, our bodies, our minds, our thinking. You will restore us in every way. In fact, you will restore and give to us everything that was once ours, but was stolen from us, either by our mistakes or by even the enemy deceiving us to lose it. Father, we thank you because as you have restored salvation to us, Lord, you will restore salvation. As you have restored salvation to mankind, in the same way, Lord, you will restore to us all the other things that you have purposed and given to us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Prayer of promise. Thank you for your promises. Your promises are words you have spoken without us compelling you. You have freely promised, and we pray that we will be the receivers of all you have promised us. In order to see the fulfillment of God's promises, we need to first believe that these promises are specifically for us. God wants us to fulfill his promises for our lives, but that doesn't mean we don't have a part to play in their fulfillment. We need to believe his promises and claim them. Just like we have several instances in the Bible where God has promised and fulfilled his promises, we borrow an example from Abraham, who signifies a man of faith. And he believed God promised him a child in his old age, a time when himself and Sarah were of laughable age, but they held on to that promises. In the same way, Lord, we hold on to all the promises you have for us in our life, all that you have desired for us, all that has been proclaimed on our life, either through prophetic words, visions, or in any manner that it has been manifested unto us. We will not waver. We'll hold on to that promises because we know that it will come to end. And for any of us who are in a point where we are seeking wisdom from God, just like Solomon in the Bible also asked, a breath of understanding and measureless as the sand of the seashore was given to him. If we are at any crossroad in our lives now and we're wondering which way to go, what to do with our education, what to do with the house we're living in, should we park or should we move to another place, should we relocate to another country, what shall we do with our work? Is it time to move on to another type of job? What shall we do with our family setting? Shall we expand? Shall we get more? Shall we increase in our fold? Any of those things, God, we know that if we ask for wisdom, you will grant us that wisdom in making a decision. Also, Lord, we pray that you come and protect our families. And just like you promised God, David in the Bible, that it came to pass all the promises that you gave to him, and you spared his life in whilst they were in Israel. That will also come to us. So Lord, this morning we also pray that it is not just having these promises. We also have a part to play in this at claiming these promises that you have for us. And one of them is searching the Bible to understand these promises and holding on to these claims. Meditating on them, God, give us the grace and the mind to meditate in these promises so that we can see them come to pass, and also personalizing them, making the promises feel like it is for us, speaking a word of faith for us to claim this, and the patience, because that something that has been promised to you does not come today, it does not mean that it's not there. In everything, God has his own plan and is very sovereign in all his ways. Lord, we pray that all these promises you have for us will come to end. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Prayer of protection. Lord, we pray for your protection, and we bring before you all those with heavy and anxious minds. For you alone can take all anxiety and make peace that surpasses all understanding. I pray for protection over all of us, that you fill us with your holy presence to find rest and protection. Keep us safe, hidden, and secure under your wings, where we will always find refuge and strength, for you are our hiding place. Whenever we are in doubt or fear and insecurity, Father, please take control and remind us that your presence is near. Let your love, faithfulness, goodness, and mercy surround us daily, so that we will not know fear, whatever might come our way or against us. Shield us with your love, guide us with your truth, and defend and deliver us in this hour and moment as we put our trust in you. Lord, as we're resuming a new beginning, a new month, a new week, be it at school, place of work or visit, we ask that your presence goes with every single one of us. We speak grace, peace, mercy, and orderliness in every place that we will set foot. Protect us from whatever trouble that might come our way. And no matter what, Lord, we continue to look up to you as our protector, the one that fights for us each day. Father, we're entrusting our children into your hands as they return back to school. Please watch over them and protect them from all negative influences. Help them to be a light to others and give them courage to walk through every single day. Help them to remember that when they are scared, that you are always with them. And we pray that we as parents, Lord, will continue to remain an encouragement to them. And for all those that are in places of authority, Lord, we ask that you grant them wisdom, knowledge, and perseverance to make the best decisions in the interest of the people. Let them be wise in applying the truth. Give us the strength, O Lord, to be able to follow and the power to practice and continue with our day-to-day lives without fear, as we trust in every single promise that you have made that you will keep us safe. Strengthen the medical providers and caregivers, O Lord. Protect all who are at exposure at the risk to this virus. Give strength to the weak and provide for the needy. Let them know that you are indeed God Almighty. Please watch over our family and our loved ones. Guide every single one of them along the best paths and spare all of us from all forms of illnesses. Let us unite in hope, and we'll be enlightened in our faith at this very hour. Lord, we thank you for the fresh grace ahead this week. Father, this week is full of promises. We believe that you will lead our way and you will fill our hearts with love and joy. Please guide our decisions, our responses, and all our efforts. No matter what the circumstances, O Lord, help us to remain steadfast and trusting in you over our lives. Father, we're thanking you for your promise and your command over your angels to guard over us. No matter the height, the breadth, or depth, Father, we believe that nothing can extend beyond your power or reach. And in that, Lord, we entrust you and we ask that, Father, you recognize everything that concerns us, and we have overcome all evil. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll now have our final song for today's service.
shepherd, I shall not want. In green pastures, he makes me lie down. He restores my soul and leads me on for his name, for his grace. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days, and I will dwell in your house forever.
So our church notices for this week. On Wednesday, we'll have our regular Bible study, and we will be looking at the book of Galatians with an 8 p.m. start. And finally, next Sunday, we'll be back in church, and that is the 6th of September at 11 a.m. So we'll be excited to see everybody face to face again. Now, before we say the benediction, can I ask Auntie Fumi to lead us in closing prayer, please?
Father, we thank you. We thank you that you have been with us. We thank you that we can, our hope and our trust is in you. And we thank you because you are always available to us. For the rest of this week, we just commit ourselves to you. We ask, O God, for your wisdom on a day-to-day basis, that you will guide our footsteps and you will guide our decisions, that in everything that we do, O God, we will, our lives will bring glory to you. Father, this week, make us open to your word. Help us so that we can be your hands and your ears and your voice to the needy. Help us to recognize and to be observant of the needs of the people around us. We surrender ourselves to you and we say, Father, just take absolute control of our lives in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Now, can we all unmute ourselves so we can say the grace together, please.
Into the grace?
Yes.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore.
Amen.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us
all the days of our lives,
and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. And that is the end of our service.
Thank you. Resident Pastor.
So well.
Thank you.
You.
Well done.
Oh, look, something will come. Nitola and the girls.
Yeah, we're heading home.
Morning, everyone. Morning, Justin. Morning, Auntie. Hi, afternoon, even.
Hello, the holiday makers, all the recent makers, bank holiday, holiday makers. Yeah. Hello.
Hey, Lulu. Saw you there.
Yes. Whoa. Lovely.
Hi, Auntie Lydia. Morning, bye. Lydia.
Bye, Simone.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Good morning,
bye.
Bye.
See everyone next week.
Have a good week.
Bye, Auntie Lydia. Oh. Bye.
Bye, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Who left?
Bye, everybody's
leaving. Look at the one that's on this.
Yes,
how is it out there? You're looking so cozy. Are you sure you'll come back at all?
I know.
You're looking like you've made there your home.
Yeah, I am.
Everything set up. You even came with play mat for Kenny. So I see you're not coming back at all. Oh, that's nice.
Bye, children.
Bye.
Tammy, you did so well. Confident. Have you been practicing?
No,
so
this is natural talent.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Work it.
Holding on to your
very natural.
Fully.
Very natural.
Well done.
Thank you.
I'll tell you.
I mean, I don't really have a team I'm supporting. This is just my default.
You mean football team?
Yeah.
So your media team. You have a media team with Pastor now.
Yes.
I'm going to definitely send this.
Okay.
See you as well.
Hello, children. Hi, Tayo. Hello,
Auntie. Hi.
Where's Jesse today?
Oh, he's just playing with his train set. Jesse. Come and say hello.
Are you okay?
He's being shy.
Hello, shy. Yeah, they are here. Mommy. Which mom is asking of you? She's here.
Let me see your hair.
Ooh. Ah. Yeah, they were here. They just left. Yeah, they were sitting in the position. Is it cold where you guys are? It's cold here. I'm even using the heater.
Around me.
Well, yeah, it's cold. It's cold. Yeah, there was a bit of sunshine in the morning today, but it's gone dull and cold and looks like it's going to rain even.
Kenya's going to be good this morning.
Oh, fantastic. And so who's cooking dinner today? Tell me, have you got food to cook? Did they leave you food?
No, I can take care of myself.
You can take care of yourself. So that's another default. You can take care of yourself.
Yeah.
You can cook your own food. Okay, I'm gonna love you guys and leave you.
Bye.
But there are some days we could hardly see your faces. You're so that's far right. away.
Yeah.
We can just see bodies. We can't see any face. Yes, sweet to Pie, sweet to Yinka. We can see you waving. I can just barely make out who is who. I can see that all. I can see Pastor standing up. Bye, everyone. I see Kemi coming to the media.
Kemi,
happy little baby. What's written there? Happy little
loved.
Hi, Kemi.
Kems.
Fabulous.
Happy little.
Of course, you look at the screen. You see at the top.
Happy little loves. Oh, I see.
Happy little.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Have a good week. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Kemi. Bye, Pastor.
Okay, then. Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye.